Richard Marks.
Very exciting for me to have you here. It's
thanks,
super,
man.
It's a pleasure. I'm like a huge fan. We've talked on the phone. It's probably one of your most memorable moments in your career, so I'm sure you remember all of it. But
I memorized it.
Thank you. Yes, he just
I dream it.
He listens back.
I'm a massive fan, so just I'll geek out
really
early
nice,
and
thank
say
you.
Thank you. I was telling the show that if either one of the versions of your career it would just be isolated, you'd be a Hall of Famer, either the artist part or even just the songwriter part.
But because there's two, there's no chance.
It's you know, it's like I would say you're.
It's like splitting the vote.
So yes. No, I don't think so. I think it's more like Tom Brady.
Okay, there you go. I'm going to go with that.
Because if you take the first half of his career, he's still in the Hall of Fame.
True.
If you take the back half of his career, he's still in the Hall of Fame.
True. I've been really lucky, actually.
But luck. Do you even believe in luck?
Yeah. I think you make your own.
Okay, fair. What's the luckiest thing to ever happen to you then in your career?
The luckiest thing to ever happen in my career mm-hmm. would be being born to the parents I was born to, who were not only super supportive, but musically talented. So I think I got some genetics. So that was luck.
Did they play or did they just have a lot of music in the house?
My dad was just a badass musician, but like best piano player I ever heard, jazz piano player, classical jazz. And then he became a jingle composer, producer, and orchestrator, conductor. He was like the most talented musician I ever knew. And my mom was a great singer.
Outwardly? Publicly?
Yeah, she sang on all the commercials that my dad did.
Do you think that you kind of acquired that through being around it as a child, or were you drawn to it because you wanted to impress or have that closeness with your parents?
I started singing before I could talk, I think. So it was something I always did. It wasn't like a conscious decision. And then when I was probably like 5 or 6, I was singing monkey songs around the house enough that my dad said, you know, we're doing a candy bar commercial. I wonder, and he put me behind the microphone in the studio and that was it. And I just went to it. You know, it was like the most natural thing. And then the songwriting thing was natural in high school in that I was just trying to pick up girls, you know, like I didn't have game. So
you weren't like super, I mean, cause you've been super good looking as long as I've known you.
Well, you just met me.
No, but I mean, I used to like know you, even though you didn't know me. You know, were you the awkward kid, or were you the guy that says you were the awkward kid now, but you were always the
those guys.
That guy. Yeah, yeah.
No, if you ask, in fact, tomorrow night, my first crush is coming to the show. Her name is Lynn, and she would, if she were here, she would probably tell the truth, which was that I just didn't have like girls wanted to be my friend. You know what I mean? Like, that's the last thing you want to hear when you're a sophomore in high school. But I just thought, you know, well, I got to do something that sets me apart in order to create game. And so I started writing songs and playing and, you know.
When parents have a career, especially in art, a lot of the folks that I know are like, my parents did not want me to do this because they saw exactly how hard it was.
Yeah.
What was your relationship like with your parents whenever you say, thank you. Thanks for exposing me to this, but now I want to go do it for real.
There was no pushback. The fact that I went to my parents in my senior year of high school and said, you know what? I'm actually not going to go to college next year. I'm going to go out to LA and try to make it out there. The first thing they said was, go, do, you know? You can always go back to school.
Wow.
And they said, you know, even my dad was like, don't have a backup plan. This is your only plan. Just go make it happen. And so to have parents who were both so supportive was key. And again, it goes back to luck because, you know, you don't pick your parents.
Did you do the band thing in high school? Did you get with a group of buddies?
Oh, man, I tried. I tried to put bands together left and right, and nobody took it seriously. I came from a suburb of Chicago where the idea of being in the arts, the idea of being a rock star or any of that was such a pipe dream. You were going to be an accountant. You were going to be a lawyer. It where I grew up, there was nobody from there really that had done that. So nobody really took it seriously. So I just dove into songwriting, which was actually great because a few years later when I did go out to LA, that's kind of how I started to get going, was as a writer for other people.
But were there songwriters where you were?
Because no, nobody.
So
I was the only kid in school.
How did you learn to write songs by yourself at a place where no one else is really writing songs like you were writing songs?
I went to the school of Elton John and Billy Joel and the Eagles and That's all I did. When I wasn't doing math homework, when I wasn't doing the schoolwork that I was forced to do, I was just listening to music and memorizing every nuance of every record. I was paying attention to production and arranging, and I went to, like, I just studied it, like, out of love. So when I ended up in LA at 18, I got my first job was singing background vocals on a Lionel Richie record. He was really the catalyst. He was the guy. He heard my demo tape of my first couple of songs and actually called my parents' house. This is when he was, like, leaving the Commodores and maybe next to Michael Jackson, arguably the biggest star in the music business. This guy took the time to call some kid in Chicago he didn't know. And he just encouraged me. He said, you know, I really like your voice. And these are your first songs? Man, you should have heard my first songs. So when I moved out to L.A., he had me sing some background vocals. And then he recommended me as a singer to Kenny Rogers, his buddy. And that's how I started writing songs. I wrote songs for Kenny Rogers. That's how my songwriting career started.
It's funny that Lionel, because I know Lionel pretty well from working with him for...
It was his birthday yesterday.
4 years on American Idol. I went through some stuff and he pulled me aside and, like, gave me advice. He's awesome. But it's funny that he's always been that way.
He's always been that way. He's a class act and he's so generous with his time. He's a little bit... I really don't know anybody else. I've never known anybody else who has that level of grace about themselves and who go out of their way to be encouraging of people where there's going to be nothing paid back. He's just that good a guy.
And so he recommends you to Kenny Rogers and you go to sing background vocals for Kenny. So are you the guy?
Yeah.
Are there three behind and you're doing the dances at the same?
I'm only in the studio.
Oh,
I'm
just
not doing
studio.
Any live work. Yeah.
Got it.
I get hired to work for 2 days on this Kenny Rogers album. And it was in the, like, towards the end of the making of that album. And so I go in and I've sang some harmonies and stuff on this one track or two tracks. And then I knew I was coming back the next day. And during the session, I overheard Kenny say to his producer that they still needed one more song. And he even described it. He said, man, we still need one more ballad. We need that, like, sort of Lionel-ish ballad. We got to find it.
You hear this conversation happening.
I overhear this conversation. I go home to my apartment in L.A. I write a song. I come back the next day, and I do exactly what the background singer should never do, which is go up to the artist and say, I'm a songwriter. I've got a song. And again, grace. Kenny Rogers could have immediately called security and had me escorted to my car and instead said, well, let me hear it. And we sat down at the piano and I played it. My hands were shaking. And he liked it.
You knew it? You can remember it? Did you memorize it from that night?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. And it was a number one country song.
And the song was?
Crazy. Crazy for you. Can't you see? That's my Kenny Rogers.
That's like
impression.
85 or so? Kenny
yeah,
Rogers
85,
crazy?
84 maybe.
Yeah. So.
I was 19 when I wrote it.
Did that song fall out of you that night? Do you feel like things just come from special places, or were you just so dead?
Yeah, most of them do.
Yeah.
Especially when you're inspired by opportunity. Like, to me, I thought, I'm going to be able to hand a song. Well, I'd made a little cassette tape of it. He didn't want to hear it. He just wanted me to play it on the piano. I wouldn't have had that opportunity had I not been in there as a background singer. So I looked at all of these things historically as being, writing to an opportunity. Do you know what I mean?
I do. And so you found the opportunity, you shot your shot.
Yeah.
That one happened to work.
Yeah.
But you went from being a background singer to now you're a writer that has a song, the song went number one. So then what do you then focus on songwriting more, or do you still want to sing and because you have got two paths now you can choose from.
Yeah. Well, I mean, all along I'm writing pop rock songs. To try to get a deal. I'm getting rejected by every label.
Right, but now you have a door that's been opened, right?
Yeah, and then I started getting a lot of work as a background singer and then writing songs for different people. But along the way, I like David Foster, the producer, who was a hero of mine when I met him, an incredibly talented guy, but he told me I shouldn't sing.
Because?
He said, you don't have it. Like, you don't...
Oh, like you... Got it.
You shouldn't... You should just write songs. You're not an artist. You shouldn't make records. You shouldn't even try for a record deal. And luckily, I didn't listen to him.
Did you think for a while, maybe you should listen to him?
Only because we had, at the time, we had a pretty close friendship, and it kind of killed me. Mm. It's like your dad saying, you know, you're kind of unattractive. But I then it sort of just turned a little bit into fire in my belly, like to prove him wrong, which was in a sort of big brother kind of way. we joke about it now.
So you guys are cool now?
Yeah, we hardly see each other, but when we do,
you don't want to. You don't.
We
punch
joke
him
about it
when you see him.
No, I punched him a long time ago.
Yeah. So from 84, 85, when that song comes out, and 89 is right here waiting when that fine when that hits number one. Right, some of my years are.
Yeah, well, the first album was 87.
So when does Right Here Waiting become the massive hit when I would see you on TV?
Well, that was like my fifth top five single or something.
What?
Like that.
Really?
Yeah, because we had Don't Mean Nothing, Should Have Known Better, Endless Summer Nights.
I'm a massive Cubs fan, so my first memory of you...
Oh, was the Cubs video? Mm-hmm. That was like a couple years after Right Here Waiting.
Because I knew Right Here Waiting for hearing on the radio, but you didn't always know what people look like.
Right,
it's way different than now, where you just easily get on Instagram and see people's faces.
Right,
but when I kind of put it all together, was me. I mean, listen, I was a massive Cubs fan. It was, you know, Mark Gray, Sandberg, Vance Law, Sean Dunstan, Maddox. Oh, I mean, I was diehard.
Yeah,
and I was
had
like
Greg Maddux in my video.
That video?
Yeah.
Well, I don't remember that, but I just remember thinking that's my guy. I don't know what that's him. He's a Cubs
fan.
That
guy with that big fluffy mullet. That's my guy.
Yeah, that's my guy right there. So your first. As an artist, who gave you the first shot there to go, hey, we'd like for you to make a record as an artist, as you?
Oh, that was a guy, we just lost him a few years ago, but he was sort of a kind of a Clive Davis-esque executive named Bruce Lundvall. And man, he heard the same songs that every other label had rejected for years. And he just loved them. And he was like, I love what you do. Let's go make a record. And I got signed to a one-album deal with this little subsidiary of EMI. And the first single just blew up, and that was it. We were off to the races for, you know, 10 years.
What was the first single?
Don't Mean Nothing.
Mm, dang.
Joe Walsh played guitar on it. Like, so many things fell into place so quickly and easily that it was a little like, is this really happening? And I had Timothy Schmidt and Randy Meisner singing background vocals. So I had three Eagles on my first single. You think that helped get on rock radio?
Timothy
bit.
Schmidt, hi, he's the soprano?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's the guy that sang... can't tell you why.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Dang, so you're like baptized into greatness right there with your...
Yeah.
And do you think, like you just said, man, is this all going to be so easy? And does it get easier? Like, when was the first adversity you had as an artist? Once, because you come out and you got a big song. When does that first bit of adversity
Well, I had adversity in that I never had success because of or with the support of my record company. After the guy that signed me... I did one album and then he got booted. So then I had to deal with guys who hadn't signed me. And it was just everything was a battle. The song choices, the single choices. I was told by the label that Right Here Waiting would never be a hit because it had no drums. You know, like stuff like that. And we would just sort of, you have to bet on yourself and you have to have a level of non-compromise in order to see your... Like, I'm fine to fail on my own. Like, if it's my fault, it's my fault. But I don't want to fail because you screwed up. You know what I mean? Because I'll never forgive you.
I screw up a lot and you'd want to punch me. Yeah.
Yeah.
If it's my fault, yeah.
Yeah.
Right Here Waiting, song you're known for most, would you say? Is that the one?
It's probably, yeah.
Do you play it last?
Yes. Because you can't follow it. Because it's one of those songs where, like, you know, you can't. Like, once you play that. I mean, I've done that before, and it has worked, but there's just something about that song around the world, you know. I remember, you know, not that long ago, I was in Australia and touring, and I had the morning off to myself, and I was walking through this little, off the beaten path of this little town. And it was early in the morning, and this woman, she owned a flower shop, and she was setting up the display. So the door was open to the store, and she had her back to the street. And as I passed, she was singing Right Here Waiting as I walked by. Of course, I was tempted to go, hey, that's me. But I just stood there and got the biggest smile on my face because it's the other side of the world, you know? And I'll go to Sri Lanka, and I'll start playing that song, and the audience starts singing it. You know, it doesn't matter where in the world. So I even though I've had other number one songs, there's nothing that sort of compares to, that's almost like, Right Here Waiting has sort of become like Kumbaya, you know, like kids know it. It's
Did you crazy. Ever have a phase where you're like, I don't want to play that anymore?
No.
Ever?
No, of course not.
Well, good for you. A lot of, obviously, you know.
I know, I don't get that. Like, and maybe it's, I think it's less with the people who wrote their hits, because if we're lucky enough to have written and created these songs that people really love, why would you not want to play it? I mean, I haven't lost any love for, I mean, some I like more than others, but there's none in the set list that I ever go, oh God, not that one again. Because I wouldn't have recorded it if I didn't think it was a good song.
Do you play that one on guitar? You have a guitar with you. Do you play Right Here Waiting on guitar or just piano?
I can. I play it on the piano in my show.
Can you give us a little bit on guitar?
Yeah, sure. Oceans apart, day after day, and I slowly go insane. I hear your voice on the line, but it doesn't stop the pain. If I see you next, never. How can we say forever? Wherever you go, whatever you do, I will be right here waiting for you. Whatever it takes, or how my heart breaks, I will be right here waiting.
Original key?
Think so, yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. You can still sing in original key.
Well, thanks, man.
Yeah, dang. I, you know, sometimes it's like, well, I will be right here.
I'm almost 60. Talk to me in 10 years and maybe we'll.
That's awesome.
Maybe I'll be like, wherever. Yeah, yeah.
So you ever do one of the bad deals that we see, like TLC or Backstreet Boys? You ever sign one of those crazy deals and you're like, now I owe 72 records? And
oh, no. No, I luckily, you know, the other thing, talk about luck and my parents. My father was not only a really brilliant musician and, you know, creatively brilliant, but he was a really good businessman. So he kind of taught me that it was the music business. So I don't think I've ever really made a bad deal. You know, kept my stuff. And I think I've been pretty smart with the business of music, yeah.
Did you ever get to a stage creatively where you thought, you know, I really love the music I've been writing, but I think now I want to do like a metal record or put a hip hop, or you just wanted to change something. Did you ever have that feeling?
Not to that degree, but, you know, actually it's funny, during the pandemic, I did you know, the band Trivium? Mm-hmm. Matt Heafy, the guy, the guitar player, singer, the screamer really from that group, reached out to me and said, I got this idea for a metal version of Right Here Waiting, and we did it. And it's actually pretty cool.
What did you do on it?
I sang it, and then he screamed. Yeah, he did that. But I sang it really differently. I sang it in a way that it kind of didn't sound like, wherever, you know, it wasn't, I was like with a lot of edge to it.
Yeah.
It was pretty cool. And as a songwriter, you know, I've been able to write for all these different artists, from country artists and R&B artists and rock bands and stuff like that. So I feel pretty comfortable jumping genre to genre. But like to do a hip hop record or something, it would just be inauthentic.
Did you ever want to put a rapper on any of your songs in the 90s?
No, that wasn't the music that I was making. Yeah. I loved it, but it wasn't what I was doing.
Pop music is really wild because it's so global. I would imagine you've played your hits in countries where you have no idea what the language is being spoken.
Oh yeah, and
they sing it in
broken English. They just like Right Here Waiting. I mean, it's not just that one. There are a handful of songs that were, no matter where I go. You know, I wrote this song years ago called Hazard. That's like this murder mystery set to music that was a big hit for me in like early 90s, and I've played in. It's a story song with characters and a plot. And I'll have people in Germany. And like the song was a hit in all these countries. Like it was number one in like 14 different countries. And most of them were non-English speaking countries. And it just baffles me that people could be into it like that. You know what I mean? Like, I understand a really catchy, poppy song, but this is like this minor key, dark. I never thought it would be a hit. I just wrote it as a sort of like as an exercise to, because I'd never written a story song before. And the song just blew up around the world. And to this day, I have people ask me about it, and I play it, and people sing it, and it still blows my mind.
You have all these number one songs as a performer, as a songwriter. Did you ever get to a stage where you're like, I'm tired of touring? Like, you're just literally physically tired. And is that, did you ever focus in on songwriting? Like, I need to get this creative out of me. I'm going to do it this way. Or did you just have all these songs? That's what you did anyway.
No, I definitely, like at the end of about 10 years, where everything just fired on all cylinders, nothing but hits, nothing but big tours and all that. I finally, after like 10 years, I put out a record that went double plywood instead of double platinum. And it was sort of like, it was the end of the 90s. It wasn't just me. It was all the guys sort of lumped in with me, Brian Adams and Michael Bolton and Billy Joel. And like we, all of us, all the white male singer-songwriters kind of stopped getting played on pop radio. And I thought, okay, do I contort myself into something to try to, or do I just write songs? And I thought, you know what? If this is it, this is it. I've had a great 10 years, but I've got a lot of music in me. And so I really then stopped touring, stopped making records for a while, for years, and just focused on writing and producing. And luckily, that career immediately sort of blossomed. And so then I got to write, I wrote songs for NSYNC and Josh Groban and a bunch of country artists and like all over the map.
The NSYNC song, This I Promise You, we were talking about it before you came in. When you wrote that, did you write that for you, or was it for NSYNC, or was it for I'm writing this and we'll see who fits?
I got the call to see if I had a song for NSYNC right after I had written it, and I had written it for this girl trio, this all-sister trio that I had seen at a friend's wedding, and I was going to help try to get them a record. They were amazing. And I tried to get them a record deal, but their father was a real sort of, he had to be involved in everything and he wanted to be part of the group. And it was just, it got kind of funky. So I kind of backed out of the whole thing. But I had written, they didn't write songs. So I thought I need a really great three-part harmony song for this girl group. And I swear to God, man, once I had bailed out of that deal, I think it was like within a week, I get a call. Do you have a song for NSYNC? I was like, why, yes, I do. And luckily, they loved it, and then I went in and produced it and worked with those guys, and it was a big hit.
In the early 2000s, when CDs are being bought and that's a massive hit, is that real money?
Oh, man.
Because
there's no compare. You know, I have three sons, and they're all musicians, songwriters, singers. My middle son, Lucas, has had somewhat of a – he's getting there. You know, he had a Katy Perry cut like a year and a half ago, and – works his ass off and really talented. But we were all sitting around, a bunch of us were sitting around, Lucas was there. And we were talking about just this, how the music business has changed, especially in terms of like when a big hit, what does a really big hit mean for you? And he said to his friends in front of me, he said, you know, back in the day, if dad wrote a number one song, he could buy a house. And if I'm part of a number one song now, I might be able to buy a case of Nutrageous bars. And it's kind of not that big an exaggeration.
Right. So the Keith Urban stuff, I think, is always interesting to people that know country music, because two of Keith's most famous long-lasting songs,
yeah,
you know, that were hits and last, because there are hits that don't last. There are songs that aren't hits that do last.
Right.
But these are two that were hits and he still plays and people still love, like Long Hot Summer.
Yeah.
When you wrote that song, again, who were you writing it for?
Oh, no. The songs that I've had hits with Keith, we wrote together.
So those were Keith-specifically written songs. Does Keith come to you and go, hey, Richard, I want to write with – how does that even come together?
Yeah, we were put together right after his first album. There was a guy here in Nashville, a publisher, who knew how to reach me somehow, knew I was coming to town more and more. I had written with a couple of people here. And they sent me Keith's first record, which I thought was great. And then we got together and we tried writing. We wrote together for maybe a year or two and never finished anything. Like, it didn't really click. And then I was living in Chicago at the time, and he he came to my house and stayed with me for a few days. And it wasn't, it was just to sort of to hang out. He wasn't, he was just sort of like trying to take a break from the pace of his career. And he kind of came and hid out at my house. It was over a Super Bowl Sunday, I remember. And during, I think it was during halftime, we just went down to my studio and we picked up guitars. And within like 10 minutes, we "Someday, baby, you and I are gonna be the ones." That was Better Life. It was like, that's how it happened. It wasn't like, hey, let's get together and write a song. But because that song became so big, you know, he would then every couple of years, he'd say, hey, let's try it again.
Do you play the Keith in you, your songs when you play your shows?
I do Long Hot Summer sometimes.
You do?
Yeah.
Can you play a little bit of that? Do you care?
Yeah. It's gonna be a long, hot summer. We should be together with your feet up on the dashboard now. Singing along with the radio, it's such a beautiful sound. It's when you say my name in the middle of the day, I swear I see the stars come out. And when you hold my hand and I look into your eyes, oh, I swear it looks like you're waiting on the sun to go down. The sun to go down.
Awesome.
That's a fun one.
The Luther Vandross song, Dance of My Father, I remember hearing it, not knowing who wrote it because I was just listening to it. That's like, that's a song.
Yeah.
That's a song that
really
I'm
really proud to be a part of that one.
That even writing it, you, like, this, that's got to come from something, right? There's got to be some emotion there.
Yeah. Well, Luther and I were really like, he was one of my best friends. And we'd written a handful of songs together over the years. He'd sung background vocals on some of my records. And I'd written a couple of songs with him that he'd recorded up before then. And I lost my dad in 1997, like really tragically and suddenly. And Luther Vandross was one of the only people who sort of knew what to say to me. I remember we had this 2-hour phone call and he really helped me. I was spiraling. We were really, really close. And then like 6 years later, he called me and he said, I got an idea for a song. I just have a title and I have to write it with you. And it's Dance with My Father. And that's all we had, was just the title. And so as we had done before, I went off and wrote some music and then sent it to him. And he came up with this whole story that was just, I mean, that's really the meat of the song. I mean, and he wrote that song about his own father. So I knew why he wanted to write it with me, because he knew the connection I had to my dad. But that song, you know, like, it was 10 days after he mixed that song that he had a stroke. It was the last thing he ever did. But he lived long enough for us, you know, to see us win the Song of the Year and see the success of the song. He was so proud of it. But I remember him saying, like, this is going to be the biggest song of my career. And I was like, shh, don't say things like that. Don't jinx it.
But if you only knew, every NCAA tournament at the end of it, one shining moment.
Yeah.
You know?
Right?
It's got two that made me feel completely different, but both make me feel.
I mean, sometimes it's like, I've never written a song that I thought was a hit. I have never had that experience. I know other songs, like Diane Warren, every interview she goes, I knew that was a hit the minute I, good for you. Because I just write songs that I like, but I've never been able to determine what is a hit and what's not. So they've all been surprises to me, but some more than others. And I really was shocked that Dance With My Father has become so beloved, you know? But that's there's just magic in it, you know? It's all this, like, writing a song to this day is still a piece of magic to me. If I finish another song, and I've written thousands of songs, and every time I finish another song, I go, I can't believe that. I can't believe we just did that, or I just did that.
Do you like to write by yourself?
Yeah. I do collaborate quite a bit, but my favorite thing is to write by myself. And most of my hits I've written by myself, most of them.
Man, that's awesome. For other reasons.
Yeah, yeah, you know.
Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, so a couple things here. One.
By the way, I really love the, I don't know if you guys know, but there was a real dance this morning with the transportation, which was hilarious, which was, because when you guys asked me to come in,
okay,
this my wife and I get in last night.
Yeah.
And they said, somebody said, is 10 a.m.? Yeah, as long as it's not too early. And they said, and they want to know, is it okay if they send like an Uber X or whatever? I was like, yeah, no problem. So then early this morning, I get a text from my guy in L.A. saying, Bobby was like, I'm not sending an Uber for him. So Abby is going to pick him up in a Lexus. And I was like, oh, that's so nice. That's okay. Great. Thanks. Then like 10 minutes later, nope, Dan's coming in a black Porsche. And I swear to God, I texted back, okay, now I want a Bentley.
And you know what?
Do I hear a Rolls?
Next time, you will get just that. Okay, so you, in a lot of the markets that our show is in, you're doing shows all over the country. So I definitely want to let all of our listeners know all through October, and we could roll through some of them, Chicago, St. Louis, Memphis. We're huge in Osaka, Japan. So you're doing this. What is this tour? What are you doing at these shows? Is it like a full band? Like, what's the show?
Most of the shows that you just listed will be full band shows. I do a lot of solo acoustic shows. I played 3 or 4 nights at the Franklin Theater last year. That was such a blast. It was just me. And it's a storyteller show. I tell jokes, and if somebody yells out a song, if I can remember it, I'll do it. But for this next couple of years, I've decided I'm only going to do songs live that were songs that were not good enough to make the actual albums. So the whole set list, I'm kidding.
I was about to say, I'm not coming anymore. It's all B-sides that we've been.
No way.
Wow, okay. All right.
First of all.
All demos, all show long.
Can I tell you a really funny story? Yeah. I'm going to name drop, but I don't know him. I just met him in an elevator. The one and only time I ever met Bono. And it was a few years ago, and I was my son and I were leaving this restaurant, and we were getting in the elevator, and these guys went, "Hey, can you hold the elevator?" And so we held the elevator, and one of the guys, they walk in, and it's one of them's Bono. I was like, "Oh man!" He goes, "Richard, hey, it's nice to meet you." I couldn't believe he knew who I was, and so we had this little chat. And as the elevator was about to open, he said, "So, are you on tour?" And I said, "Nah, I just do shows." And he cracked up. He goes, "Oh my God, we need to start doing that." I said, well, you guys have a different situation. But what I mean by that is, for years and years, it would be like, I'm on tour to promote this. No. When you get to a certain point, if you're lucky enough to have had a catalog of songs, it's just I go out and play the songs people want to hear. And I pepper it with 2 or 3 new songs here and there, but it's hits. Because that's what I would want to go see. If I go see a band play, I don't want to hear a bunch of songs from the new album.
I saw R.E.M. once. They only played their new album and not a single hit.
Well, that's a dick move.
That's tough. That's tough.
That's a dick move to the audience.
It is tough.
Yeah.
And I was really upset.
Yeah.
And at the end, I was like, maybe they'll play What's the Frequency, Kenneth? Anything. Just give me one hit at the very end. And they finished the final track of this new album and good night.
Yeah.
And I thought Richard Marx would never do that.
I would never do that.
I thought he may play a night full of demos, but he will never do that.
But that's fun.
That sounds like something I'd sign up for. So, yeah, all the shows, go to richardmarx.com. And when we had you on, the songwriter album. Songwriter is what it was called, right?
Yeah.
And it was different elements, genre elements.
It was 20 songs. It was 5 pop songs, 5 rock songs, 5 country songs, 5 ballads.
How did people react to that? They like it?
Yeah, it did really well. Yeah,
doing that kind of project?
It was really fun for me. And you know, I just said that I like to write by myself, but that was the most collaborative album I ever did as a songwriter, in that there were songs. There were a handful of songs I wrote by myself, but I wrote a song with Keith, an old song that he didn't want to do anymore, that I always loved. There was a song that I co-wrote with Darius. There was a song I co-wrote with Chris Daughtry. There was a song I co-wrote with Burt Bacharach, like just a couple of years before he passed. Just like a crazy array of collaborators and different genres. And it was a blast.
Well, I hope you guys go see Richard. RichardMarx.com is the website.
And at the Symphony tomorrow.
Yes. And we mentioned that earlier. And that's a really cool place, too, to have a show.
Oh, yeah.
It sounds awesome. It looks awesome. It feels like you're fancy.
I played there a few years ago. It's money.
Like, it feels
absolutely
fancy.
Gorgeous.
It feels fancy walking
fancy.
In.
I'm
you
gonna
better
dress,
be fancy
gonna,
in there.
Dress
you better
up.
Be fancy. Yes.
Yeah.
Got to be fancy walking out.
Absolutely.
You have to speak British. Some of the time, they'll kick you out.
I'm going to, like, affect.
Absolutely.
Like a semi-British.
Make sound richer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes. It's not quite British, but you know, like.
No, I'm going to really work on my pretentiousness. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to be really super pretentious.
Not British.
Because that endears you to the audience, too, is when they feel like you're being really pretentious.
And you're better than them and you know it.
And I'm going to play a bunch of songs that they don't know.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Massive fan, in all seriousness.
Thank you.
You're very generous with your time and to come up here. And which car would you like to go back in? We've got a few options for you here.
I was told a helicopter was available. But.
Well, you know, it's whatever you need here. Richard, thank you. You guys, thank RichardMarks.com. Go to the shows, and we'll be back in 1 second.